Good morning, everyone. Oh, come on, we can do better than that. Have you said hello to someone other than your partner or your children? You might even not say hello to your children this morning. Why don't you turn around and just say hello? Fantastic to see here at the bridge. Get your guitar out. Why don't you stand with me? Do you know, can you think of something this morning that you can praise God for? Put your hand up. Everyone should have the hand up. Whether you're here in church live or whether you're online live. I said that because we've got a lady called Louise Fletcher. And some people are wondering, why is everyone cheering about Louise Fletcher? Louise is watching us online, so welcome, Louise. Tuesday of this week, she had a kidney transplant. Now, that is a major step in anyone's life, but she just had all that story leading up to that on social media. And she's enjoyed a chocolate pudding for the first time. You know, it's amazing what you miss, isn't it? A chocolate pudding. But we have so much to be thankful. So Louise, welcome to this service for all those who continue to pray for us, which is all your Bridge family. Let's pray together. Oh, by the way, I don't think she's online for the worship. She's online for the Barry Woodward, who's speaking this morning. Let's give Barry and Tina a warm welcome. Well, that's very polite, very conservative, that. We're going to a song after I pray that says, "Everyone that has breath, praise the Lord." Praise the Lord. Let's pray together. God, I thank you for every individual in here. I thank you, God, for everyone online. I thank you, God, for that miracle of miracles where we can have a transplant, and that transplant means that we can have a better and fuller life. Thank you for Louise and all her family and people who've been praying for her. God, we have so much to be thankful for. We really, really have. As we consider your glory, as we are going to listen the story that Barry's going to share with us, God, we just put our hands in the air and say, God, we're not perfect, but we've had an encounter with the living God. Everyone that has breath, praise the Lord. We are a thankful people. We're going to worship you with all that we've got this morning. For anyone who's not sure what's going on, I just pray your hearts and mine would be open to the fullness of everything that God has for you in this moment in your life. Amen. Amen. Let's praise God.
much that you have changed so many lives in this room, God. That you have opened doors that weren't open, God. And you healed and restored. And you caused change. And Father, as we send our children to Bridge Kids, Father, we just thank you for them, God. We thank you for what you can do in their lives. But we also thank you, God, for what our kids can do knowing you. We thank you for them. In Jesus' name.
I just wanna speak the name of Jesus.
time out. Just sing us. Just go back into that over our family. Just sing it over. Do you know what we've got to do in life is we've got to make a declaration of what we're going to say, we're going to give to our Jesus. You know, we sang a song right at the start that says, "Good, good God." And actually, some of you might think, well, it don't feel like that in my world. I've been in places in my life and very difficult places where God has seemed a million miles away. And all I've done is clung on to the hope that God is there through me those times. When I look back, God was with me in a powerful way. So whatever you're facing and you've got to declare over your life, declare it as we just go back into this song again. Declare it over your family. Declare it over your health. Declare it over your relationships. And may I say this, if you haven't considered Jesus being the center of your life, perhaps it's time to declare once and for all that Jesus, that we sing about, we love, we passionately lay our lives down for, is worthy of our everything. Thanks, Ima. Know what you're ready for now? To give the offering. Please take your seats. Do you know, in the same passion that I share, any word that I share, I have got testimony and testimony of the goodness of God through my giving. I've always done it ever since I started up my own business many, many decades ago. I've always given a tenth of whatever I've earned, and then I give offerings on top, depending on where the need is and what the challenge is. This isn't for me. This is to your God that you just sang about. He's worthy of our best. So as the stewards come round, consider what you give to God and what you be giving to God. Is it a scrap? That'll do. Is it, I just remember on a Sunday and I'll get my phone up and do it on? Or is it a lifestyle? Because when it becomes a lifestyle, it affects your bank balance, and every month it will come out as it does. So if you see the buckets come along and we don't put something in, it's because it's on standing order, just in case you think we don't give. We do. So this is another act of worship. So just give with a grateful heart. It goes to the work in our community and far beyond. God, we thank you for opportunity. We know the need is great in any community, but we thank you that this is an oasis where people can come and just be loved and be cherished, be helped and supported, and be put on that next step where they can come consider that there's more to life than the way that they've been living. God, this is your kingdom and your kingdom come. We pray a blessing on this place in here and in Horwich, everyone online, this moment that we say, here you are, God, have our best once more. Thank you. Just as the stewards continue to say, we're going to watch Bridge News on your screens. Thank you.
This week we have life groups. Life groups are happening across various locations and they are a great way to get connected and meet new people. If you'd like to be part of one or would like more information, then please visit the link after the service.
We're born curious. We were created to be. We ask, we question, we learn and grow. We've always been explorers, adventurers, dreamers and innovators. Asking what, how, and why. And there's so much more to explore together. New stories, new adventures, new loves, new joy. We're born curious. Stay curious. Try Alpha.
Kids Camp is back on the 22nd to the 25th of July. It's for those in school years 2 to 6 and will be full of games, activities and much more. The cost is £160 per child and you can book in today through bridgebolton.com. On Sunday the 21st we have a night of prayer here at Bridge Bolton. It'll start at 6pm and it'll be a great chance to come and pray with one another. See you all there.
If it's your first time with us this morning, we want to give you a warm welcome. After the service, we'd love to chat with you and answer any questions you may have. We have a gift for you as well. Please visit the link in the lounge after the service.
Wow, that bass was really bassy. I was sat on there, I nearly went off the stage there. Do you know, it's always a pleasure when we have Barry Woodward with us. Good friend of mine. We often meet up at least every quarter and we just share life together and talk about all that God's doing. If you follow him on social media, you'll see how prolific he is, whether it's going into schools, which I love, Barry. I love that you can talk to our younger generations coming through, the prisons, and obviously lots of churches around the parish, which is the UK for Barry. So without further ado, let's welcome Barry.
Nice to see you, If you'd been with us in that room, you'd have seen that crew burst in. I was sort of self-employed at the time. I was in the business of buying and selling illegal mind-bending substances. My shop premises was a first floor flat in Meredith Court, a tower block in Newham Moss Side. It was open 7 days a week, 8 till late. It was my first flat, so you can imagine, I wanted it nice. I had the living room painted up, and I put some bits from Habitat in that were all nicked. I had a top of the range sound system, all separates. Do you remember them? I had 4 speakers placed around the room. Man, you should have heard the quality. So surround sound. You could hear helicopters circling the room in the music. The drugs were strong back then. There was a visual effects too. I had an old machine that projected moving psychedelic patterns on the walls. I bought it with drugs off Chunky Pete. Late one night, it was business as usual. Me and Lisa were buzzing on speed, the music was blasting, and the old machine was going like the clappers, knocking out shapes better than the Northern Lights. You should have seen us, we were like Bonnie and Clyde wearing Reebok classics in a rave cave. Then there was a bang, bang, bang on the door. I turned the music down. No name, though. Customers always shouted it through the letterbox. Lisa went into the hallway. Seconds later, she comes rushing back in, and five lads come bursting in behind her, waving knives and baseball bats about. Four of them had balaclavas on. The one that wasn't ballied up was a weasel-faced white guy who was well psyched up. He started shouting. You should have heard him, giving out orders. One lad starts to rummage around the flat, turning things over and smashing stuff up. One of them was stocky and he had a black Lacoste jacket on. He looked right at me. Get into the bedroom now. So he grabbed me and dragged me into the bedroom and made me stand on the bed. Then the stocky one goes, where's your drugs? I've not got any. So then he starts to whack me round the legs with a baseball bat. Come on, tell us where they are. I've not got any. Then Lisa comes flying into the bedroom and lands on the deck. Loudmouth was just behind her. He'd been grilling her in the other room. He'd shoved her in. He had all of a baseball bat as well. We know they're in here somewhere. Tell us where your blankety blank drugs are. I've just sold him here. I've not got any. So then he starts to beat Lisa while she's on the floor. All right, all right, all right. I've got him here. I pulled a bag out from down my tracky bottoms. You know those plastic coin bags? It was full of little wraps like little envelopes. There you go, that's all I've got. He snatched them from the floor. Come on, let's get off. Then they all bolted. I jumped down from the bed lively and pulled Lisa up. You're all right, love? Yeah, of course, I'll be all right. Did you give him the lot, Baz? Nah, did I yet? Just some wraps of heroin. Nice move. Ah, babes. We went back into the other room. My system was untouched. So we turned the music back up and we took some more speed. That's just a taste of the chaos we were in. What about the chaos you've been in? When you've had those times on your path and it's felt like a crew has burst in on you. During the first part of the Good Book era, there was a fella in the spotlight called David. He was no stranger to chaos himself. There were times it got so bad that he said, chaos has overwhelmed me. You know, it's a cert that we all get caught up in chaos to some extent someday. What takeaways can we uncover from there then? Let's have a butcher's for those that might help today. Truths to think about, even in times of chaos. For openers, even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. If you'd have crossed paths with Dave, you'd never forget him. He was big, brash, and he had a ginger horseshoe tash. Dave got caught up in chaos when he was a criminal. He was in the Quality Street Gang, or the QSG, as they were known. This was a network of Manchester villains that was active way back. One way of making money was by running the doors of nightclubs. Once Dave was on the door of a local club, then this little bloke wearing specs, carrying flyers, comes and he starts giving them out to those in the queue. So Dave goes and grabs one from a clubber. Give the guy in the sky a try. Hey, you blankety blank blank. We don't want any of this religious rubbish being given outside here. Do one. Later that week, he was out and about in town. And do you know who was there? The bloke, he was giving out flyers. Oh no, it's him again. So he swerved him. 2 days later, there was a knock on his door. And it was him. Hi, my name's Mike. Can I just give you one of? No, you can't, you... Bang! This guy's doing my head in. Wherever I go, he's there. And now he knows where I live. He's bound to come back. I better do something. Do you know what he did? He put pictures out of top shelf magazines up all over his living room walls. And a mean top shelf. You get me? The next morning, his door went again. You've guessed it. Aye, you said your name's Mike, didn't you? My name's Dave. I'm sorry for slamming the door on you yesterday. Come in. Takes him into his living room. Sit down, Mike. Dave sits right next to him. What do you think about them up there, eh? Aren't they gorgeous? Oh, they are, Dave. They're proper gorgeous, them. Ah, so you and me are just the same then, aren't we? Well, I'm sure we are in some ways, Dave. Yeah, but not in the way we look at those women. Since I don't see them the same way you do, I see them the same way God does. He sees their hearts and he places massive value on them despite the industry that they're in. And he thought, so that means God places massive value on me then, in spite of all the madness I'm involved in. This truth, it Dave so hard. Do you know what he did next? He gave the guy in the sky a try. Listen, even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. There's a cracking line in the first part of the Bible that goes like this. God doesn't see the same way people see. People look at the outside of a person, but God looks at the heart. At the start of the naughty 90s, I got right into DJing. I could mix two records in time, Waka Wong, and in key, Chocka Chong, every time. Years later, I got into it again. So I was back on the hunt for vinyl. I found one record in a crate on the floor of a second-hand shop in York that had a Martin Luther King speech on it. Result, if you'd have been in Sgt. Pepper's nightclub in Ibiza when I was playing in there, while me and the team were in reaching out to club, as you'd have heard how I used it. Bom, 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 bom. I've come back to tell you that you are a somebody. Waka Wong, Chocka Chung. Get this. Did you know that God thinks that much about you, that his thoughts can't be counted? And did you know that he sees you as precious? And do you know that you're the apple of his eye? So this means you're a somebody too. You see, God places massive value on you. No matter what kind of chaos you might be in. Like he did, Dave. Oh, I never mentioned that he was outside Sgt. Pepper's that night, did I? With us. This time round, though, he wasn't on the door. He was on our team. And he was the one giving out flyers to those in the queue. Listen, even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. Late one night, it was business as usual, then that crew burst in. Get into the bedroom now. Even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. And other than this, even in times of chaos, you can always call for backup. It was a while ago now when I went round to my mum and dad's. If you'd have walked in with me, you'd have seen that smile on my mum's face when she saw me, and you'd have whiffed that Indian curry, my dad's favourite. He'd just had some for tea. He'd have had a garlic naan with it and a pile of poppadoms to start. He always did. This was during the time on my path when I thought I had AIDS. For 2 years, I was convinced my days were numbered. Since there was no treatment then, you can imagine that this took the chaos that I was caught up in to a whole new level. I didn't say out to anybody though. I just kept it to myself. That evening, I put on my brave face and walked in. This is a nice surprise, Baz. Yeah, ma'am. I just thought I'd pop in to see you both. I sat on the settee. My dad had his joggers on and he was sat with his leg over the arm of his chair. My mum was in her armchair with the remote control right next to her. That's because he had one too. Man, you should have seen him talk about Battle of Wills. That curry smells nice, Dad. It was bloody lovely. It was one of those vindaloos from Marks and Spencer's. We were chatting and watching telly. I think Coronation Street was on. They made a truce for that. And then I remembered when we were kids, my dad used to call me Mam Electric Legs because she walked dead fast. And then I remembered my Mam bombing it down our street, carrying about 35 bags of shopping up each arm after getting off the bus. And then I remembered when my dad pinned my gym teacher to the wall because he battered me. You touch my lad again and I'll hurt you very badly. Or worse to that effect. And then I started to think about all the bother they've had because of me. And I thought, and now, after all that, they're going to watch me get dead ill. And then they're going to see me die. I was proper devastated. I felt so bad I had to get off. I'm going to get going. I'll see you later. Them days, I was living on my own in Salford. So just around the corner, about 15 minutes away. By the time I got in, I felt even worse. So I walked into my bedroom and the only thing that I could think to do was to kneel down at the side of my bed. God, help me. You see, I'd messed my life up. I'd written myself off. So I called out to him. And since then, he has cleaned my mess up and he's written me right back in. Listen, even in times of chaos, you can always, always, always call for backup. And FYI, I didn't have AIDS. That fella that I mentioned, do you know the one who's no stranger to chaos? He learnt this first, and he said that God is near to all who call on him. To all who call on him in truth. In other words, those who are sincere, those who really mean it. He says he hears their cries for help and rescues them. What about you? Have you messed up in some way? Have you written yourself off? Could you do with some help for your situation? Listen, why not give God a try? Listen, even in times of chaos, you can always call for backup. Late one night, it was business as usual. Then that crew burst in. Get into the bedroom now. Even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. You can always call for backup. And even in times of chaos, you're able to rebuild better. You have to be on that Zoom to hear somebody who I'm calling my Exhibit A tell us how this came about for her. She said, for me, chaos was just normal, even as a kid. One time, me and my mum were living in a rehab down south, but we got kicked out because she got caught with drugs. We ended up at my auntie's. Then we lived in a hostel for a bit. And after that, we got a flat. Then my mum met this fella, so we flitted to Fleetwood and moved into a bedsit. We got evicted from there, though. We had nowhere to go, so went to the police station, and my mum asked if we could stay. So we ended up sleeping on a police cell floor. I was only about 8. Then she met this other bloke who sexually abused me. That went on for around a year. I started drinking and smoking myself by the time I was 11. It wasn't long before I was taking drugs, going to festivals and parties and all that. I got pregnant at 14. Then at 20, I had a miscarriage. 5 years after that, I got pregnant again. This is just how it was. It seemed like I was always caught up in chaos of one sort or another. It got to the point, though, when I thought, I want something better than this. Then my mate saw this event advertised on Facebook, so we went. And someone said from the stage, God wants to be part of your journey, but first you need to let him in. So I did. And then my Exhibit A said, it was after this that things did pan out for the better for me. I stopped taking drugs and all the craziness. Then I got a job doing admin and stuff. Then I met a fella at church who treated me dead different. He included me, and he wasn't just after sex like all the others. And then I became a care worker. And then I went to college. And after that, I started training to be a leader. And now, as well as getting paid to do all the administration at church, I'm the assistant leader. You see, she was right in the thick of it, and yet she got on with rebuilding her life brick by brick. Look, even in times of chaos, you're able to rebuild better. You've just seen the evidence of it. My exhibit A. A is for Adele, by the way. She used to work for me. And I was somebody speaking from the stage that she mentioned. Actually, this stage at our first FITS conference. In Bible times, there was a 70-year period where God's people was held against their will away from home, so their own towns and cities lay derelict. But Isaiah has said they will rebuild the ancient ruins. And in the end, they did. These six words paint a picture for us today. You see, God wants to join us on our journey so that with him, we can rebuild the areas of our lives that have been ruined. So our lives can be better than they've ever been before. He says, I will restore to you the years. It means those lost years. Raise your hand if you've got one or two of them. But first, you need to let him in. You need to give him a try. So where are you at today? Do you want something better? Whatever that might look like for you. Do you want to rebuild your life or even part of it? Are you ready, though, to get out the bricks that you need? Look, even in times of chaos, you're able to rebuild better. Late one night, it was business as usual. Then that crew burst in. Get into the bedroom now. Even in times of chaos, you have a high valuation placed on you. You can always call for backup. You're able to rebuild better and to go with these. Even in times of chaos, you can set out down a different track. If you'd have tapped a speaker on my phone that was on my desk just near me, you'd have heard us. Is that Mr. Woodward? Yeah, speaking. Hello, my name's Donna. I'm from More Than Insurance. Do you mind if I call you Barry? No, do we, Eck? Great. The reason why I'm ringing Barry is to find out if you've got building and contents insurance for your home. Yeah, we have. It just so happens ours is due. In fact, I was ringing around for a couple of quotes earlier on. Oh, do you want me to go give you a quote too then, Barry? Go on then, Donna. Why not? She's firing away the questions, then part way in. Have you ever had any criminal convictions, Barry? Yeah, I have. But they were ages ago. They're all spent. Doesn't matter if they're all spent before we can insure you at More Than Insure. We need to know what they are. Theft, GBH, going to quit. That's just a few of them. Then she goes, have you ever been in prison, Barry? Yeah, I have. What have you been in prison for? Possession of heroin. Then she asks, have you ever taken drugs, Barry? Yeah. What drugs have you taken? Cannabis, LSD, amphetamines, MDMA, crack. Heroin. So you've taken heroin, Barry? Yeah, I have. All this was yonks ago, though, when I was caught up in loads of chaos. I'm not anymore. So how did that change then, Barry? Well, in a nutshell, Donna, it happened after I asked God in, because that's when I set out down a different track. And I've been on it ever since. I've even wrote a book about it. It's called Once an Addict. Oh, sounds fascinating. Fair play to you. I might even buy a copy of your book to find out more, Barry. But because you've been done for theft, GBH, you're going to quit. And you've been in prison and you've been on heroin, More Than Insure. Can't insure you, Barry. Listen, even in times of chaos, you can set out down a different track. Watch this. 2,000 years ago, 2,000 miles away, God, who flung the stars into space, God, who spoke the universe into being, he put skin on. He became a man. His name is Jesus. And he came to this earth and he was tempted just like you, but he resisted. And at the age of 33, he allowed himself to be nailed to a cross. Just before that, they'd beaten him. They'd laughed at him. They'd spat on him. And he hung on that cross for 6 hours. So just picture the chaos he was caught up in that time. That was for you, though, because he died on that cross to pay the price for your faults, for your flaws, and for your failures. He died on that cross to put things right for you, which means no matter where you're at now, you can set out down a different track. It was 2 years before that day when he described this as the narrow way. And he said, only a few find it. Whether you're watching online, whether you're in this room, are you going to join me and some of the others here today in being one of those few? That's up to you. Because the decision is in your hands. Imagine you're on a few days break in London. It's your last morning, so before you check out of your hotel, you go on a short boat trip on the Thames. Then when it's done, you're walking up the street, heading back to your hotel, and you go to put your hand in your bag, but it's gone. You need to be out of your hotel in 10 minutes. Your car's parked in the basement car park of a different hotel, and your car key is in your bag. How do you think you'd react? Raise your hand if you think you stay calm. Now those of you who think you start flapping, raise your hand. I'm with you lot, because that's just what me and Tina did when it happened to us 2 summers ago. Talk about flapping. Man, we were flapping that much, we nearly flew to China. For a minute anyway, then we morphed into hyperactive project management mode. You should have seen us. Tina rushed back to the hotel to check us out on time. And the plan was is that she would wait downstairs with the bags. Then I would pick her up. Once I sorted the key out, to get into my car. That was my job. Auto locksmiths near me. 2 hours later, the skinny, short, dark, curly-haired, we make any car key man turned up in his van at the hotel where my car was, and he parked just in front of it. Right, what I need to do, I need to pick and decode the lock, then I can cut a key. It took me about an hour in all with the programming. Just leave it with me and come back later. I don't mind hanging around, to be honest, so I can watch. Do you mind? Nah, do I, heck? So he gets the lock pick and decoder tool out of his van, and he puts it into the keyhole in my driver's side door. Then he moves the little arms on the side of it along, and he clicks on each pin inside. Then to get the code, he looks at the numbers, and he measures the depth of each cut. Then he gets back into his van, types that 10-digit code into his key cutting machine, clamps the key in, presses start, and cuts it. Then he takes that key to my car, puts it in, opens the door, and gets in. This whole process was far slicker than hammering a flat-headed screwdriver and using a big pipe wrench to turn it to break the lock. That's a Salford lock pick and decoder tool. Do you know God will never pick and decode your lock, then cut a key so he can open your door? Because he puts the onus on you. You need to decide to open it, and then he'll get in. Here's one of my top verses out of the Bible just for you. Commit your future to God. Trust in him, and he will act on your behalf. Listen, even in times of chaos, you can set out down a different track. The decision is in your hands, though. It's down to you to give the guy in the sky a try, like Dave from the QSG did. I'm going to wrap this up now by paying one last visit to my shop, which was a first floor flat in a tower block in Hume. It was open 7 days a week, 8 till late. That night, me and Lisa were buzzing on speed. The music was blasting. The machine was going like the clappers. The door went. Then that crew burst in. And I know there's been times on your path when it's felt like a crew has burst in on you. So we've just had a butcher's some truce. Truce that can help. Truce for you to take away. Please stand. No going outside for a smoke just yet. Cookie. Listen up, listen up, listen up. Right now, God is stood outside your door. Yeah. He wants to be part of your journey. The decision is in your hands, though. What are you going to do? I'm going to pray a prayer. And I'm going to invite two groups of people to pray this prayer, whether you're watching online or whether you're in the room. The first group, those people who have never prayed a prayer, you have never given God consent to come in. It could be that you've been attending this church, my church. It could be that you've been attending another church. It could be that you've been watching online. It could be that you've been brought by a friend. And you've never given God consent to come in. It could be that you've got a bit of a search going on. You're trying to find God. Pray this prayer. It could be that you're a 12-stepper and you struggle with the higher power. God being the higher power. Pray this prayer. It could be that you're a young person in this church. An older person, and you've never given God consent to come in because you're just coming to please your spouse. That's good. Yeah. But God wants to step into your narrative today. He wants to step into your story. So the first group of people, those in this room, those watching online, if you've never given God consent to come in, you're going to pray this prayer. You're going to park your pride outside. You're going to put it in your pocket. You're going to do something with it to get out of the way. Don't let it get in the way. The second group of people, those in this room, those watching online, you have prayed a prayer. You've given God consent to come in. You've started a faith journey at some point in the past, but for whatever reason right now, you're not cutting it. The Bible says there's no condemnation for you, so I'm not here to give you an hard time. All I'm here to say to that second group, pray this prayer and reconnect. Get back on track. And God will forgive and forget. So they're the two groups. You're watching online, in the room. Everybody else in the room, you make up the third group. You're going to pray to encourage the first group and the second group. Are we ready? All three groups, repeat after me, phrase by phrase. Dear God, I come to you today and I admit that I'm not perfect. God, I ask that you forgive me for all my faults, for all my flaws, for all my failures. God, I ask that you wipe my slate clean. Because right now, I'm opening my door and I'm giving you consent to come in. And God, I'm calling out to you because I want to rebuild the areas of my life that have been ruined. And God, I'm saying, I'm ready to get the bricks out that I need so that with you, I can rebuild better. While their heads are bowed like this, if you prayed that prayer and you're in the room and you're part of the first group or the second group, can you put your hands up so I can see it? Keep your hands up, 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 keep your hands up. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Put your hands down. 7 people, there's more of you. 8. If you prayed that prayer, you're part of the first group or the second group in this room. There's 7 people. Raise your hands. You don't need to raise them again, but the rest of you are going to count. I'm going to count down 10 seconds. All the rest of you who prayed that prayer, you're part of the first group or the second group. You're going to park your pride outside. Put it in your bag. Do something. Get it out of the way. I'm going to give you 10 seconds. The 7 of you who raise your hand, you don't need to do it again, but the rest of you, as I count down 10 seconds. 10. Anybody else? Raise your hand so I can see it. 1 over here. Keep your hands raised. Keep your hands raised. 9 as I count down. Got you there. Anybody else? 8. Got you here. Brilliant. That's 2 more. Anybody else? That's 9 people altogether. Another one here. That's 10. That's fantastic, that. And 11. Yes. As I count down. 7. Anybody else? 6. Put your pride in your pocket. 5. Anybody else? 4. Anybody else? 3. Got you there. That's 12. 13. Anybody else? Anybody else as I count down? 3. Anybody else? 2. 1. If you're watching online and you've prayed that prayer, you're part of the first group or the second group, just put in the comment box or where, whichever way you're watching, just put, I prayed, and someone will be in contact with you. I'm going to count to 3. Those 13 people in this room who've prayed that prayer, you're part of the first group or the second group. On the point of 3, you're going to leave your seats. You're going to go through the doors the way that you walked in, and someone's going to come and stand with you. They're going to give you some basically, I brought some packs with me. Inside that pack, there's a book we want you to take home and read. There's also a little card in there with a QR code on. We want you to scan when you get to a quiet place. That will take you to a video, and I explain, what do you do next? What did I do next after starting my faith journey? So it's important that you go, all those 13 people, on the count of three, you're going to leave your seats and you're walking through the back doors. Are we ready? And all the response team, you're going to go at the same time, okay? One, two, three, you go now. Let's give them a round of applause. All those people, raise their hands. You keep going. All those people, raise your hands. Yeah, you keep going. Fantastic.
Thank you. You can take your seats. Thanks, Barry, once again for that brilliant message. So many powerful truths for all of us there as well. Yeah, let's thank Barry. I'll never take for granted getting home insurance again after that. But yeah, if there's anyone that did respond this morning and maybe haven't gone out to chat with the team outside, there will be the team still available at the side stage to chat with you and pray with you there as well. But yeah, great that people have given their lives to God this morning. That is the end of our service now. So don't forget life groups this week if you're part of a life group as well. The Alpha course as well will be starting a week on Monday. So if there's anyone else you feel that would be good for, please feel free to invite them. So that a great way to explore faith and what it is to be a follower of Jesus as well. But yeah, have a great week, everyone. We look forward to seeing you next Sunday.